This episode of the Between You and Me podcast is brought to you by our friends at Audio Feed Festival. Make sure that you get tickets now to Audio Feed July 4 to 7 in Urbana, Illinois. It is featuring some of our favorite artists, including Andy Squires, Citizens, Glenn Kaiser, Impending June, John Van Dusen, Spoken, and so many more. Friends, we love Audio Feed because not only does it promote and celebrate great music and community and faith conversations, but it's about creating a safe place for people to belong. Make sure that you go and pick up your tickets now at audiofeedfestival.com. Hello, friends, and welcome to episode 171 of the Between You and Me podcast. This is the place where we talk to music makers about the things that hurt, heal, and change us in church culture. My name is Jessica Morris. I am an Australian music journalist, and I want to say thank you so much for your support of our last episode, 170, with Charlie Peacock and Andy Ashworth. It was so much fun, and once again, thank you to the UTR team for making that possible. Now, I promised a big episode, and I bought it, because my friends, you are about to meet the one and only Andy Squires. If you haven't met or heard Andy before, let me enlighten you. Andy is an independent singer-songwriter from Charlotte, North Carolina, and he is known because he creates what I would term subversive Christian music. Now, that is not to say that Andy is trying to create conflict with his music. It's more that he feels called to say things really clearly and really honestly and really delve into the nitty-gritty of what it means to live as a Christian, as an evangelical, in this day and age. It means that I have been drawn to Andy's work for quite some time because his writing is beautiful. Andy is not just a musician, he's also a poet, as you would tell by the fact that his latest release is Poet Priest. But because of that, he is such a unique force in Christian music. And even saying he's in Christian music is nearly... it's nearly incorrect. He's nearly like on the side of Christian music, like John Mark McMillan would call the nether regions of Christian music, or like he's nearly like the rock star or the misfit side of it, informing the culture, informing what we do, but not playable on like K-Love and things like that. It's because of that that I have been, like I said, really drawn to Andy's work. And I reached out to him recently because our friends at Audio Feed Festival are preparing for their event in July, and Andy Squires is actually like their headlining act. So when I reached out to the team and said, who would you like me to talk to? And I got options, I was like, Andy Squires. I want Andy Squires. Can you get him for me? And they said yes. And I was very excited. So thank you to Kevin and the team at Audio Feed for your help. But all that to say, today, Andy and I have a fascinating conversation, not just about like his career and story, but about Christian music and the construct and the mechanism of the music industry. And we did this because in recent weeks, when you hear this, an artist by the name of Forrest Frank released like a viral TikTok video, basically sort of saying like, give us a year to reform Christian music. We're gonna make it cool. And it was fascinating because one, Forrest Frank's tunes have gone viral, for lack of a better term, on TikTok, on social media. I have used them on Reels and stuff. Even before he went like super, super famous in that way, I had heard some of his previous work and really liked it. So I'm a fan of Forrest Frank's work. But what was really curious for me when Forrest released these videos, right, was that there were a handful of Christian artists who have probably been around in the industry a lot longer and maybe had a bit more acclaim than Forrest has at this point of his career, who responded back, and they responded back very graciously, but they sort of said, here are some counterpoints. Consider this. Here is a perspective from someone who has been in this industry for a while and taken some hits and is still in it. Now, like you will hear in this episode, I see a lot of myself, like the mindset that I've had in what Forrest said about like, let's reclaim culture. Let's reclaim Christian music and make it like popular. I see a lot of myself in that from when I started in my career. And so having so many or a handful of artists who have been in this realm for a little while respond back to that and give their feedback has been really eye-opening for me, but also really life-giving. Because as I've learned through chatting with so many amazing people, there is so much more nuance to this story. This isn't just about like, let's reclaim culture for Jesus. This is about creating beautiful, authentic, transparent art, whatever that looks like, however that is received. So Andy and I chat about that today in conjunction with all sorts of things. This is just, if you love like deep nitty-gritty, let's ask the hard questions about life, you are going to love this episode. And I mean, that's what I'm here for. So my friends, you're about to hear a short bio about Andy Squires, the who, what, when, where, why of this father musician poet. And then we will get straight into the interview. Let's go. If you want to talk about subversive Christian music, we need to talk about Andy Squires. Okay, maybe subversive is too strong a word, but when it comes to writing and creating authentic music that pushes people to think about faith, life, and their beliefs, uncomfortable and all, Andy Squires is prolific. Since 2015, fans have gravitated towards his work, which is folk acoustic style of music and poems and essays. Drawn to his way of wrestling with really tough ideas and seeing them in his own life and asking hard questions, he invites us into deeper communion with God. This makes Andy somewhat of a misfit or rebel in Christian music. Then again, Andy's not out to make good Christian music, whatever that means. He just feels called to make beautiful, dangerous, and prophetic arts. And as a result, he's called many prodigals back to the table of God, or perhaps, I would say, shown them that their seat at the table of God was never taken away in the first place. I digress, because Andy Squires is an independent Christian musician and poet raised in Santa Cruz, California. He moved to North Carolina and has been living in Charlotte for years, working in the church and making music. Heavily inspired by Leonard Cohen, Bob Dylan, and later The National and John Mark McMillan, in 2016 he released an album that struck a chord with critics and fans alike. It was called Cherry Blossoms, and it scored him international acclaim with the Christian music community. Over the coming years, he would be prolific on tour, and he described his own live show as ache on display and a joyful protest. In 2017, he was featured on Taylor Leonhardt's album The River Sessions, a sign of the relationship and trust his craft had helped him forge in the faith-adjacent music community in Nashville and beyond. And to this day, Andy is still beloved and a respected friend and musician to many. Just search his Spotify and you will see that he is featured on playlists personally curated by Josh Gorels, John Mark McMillan, and our friend Elias Dummer. Come 2021, and after releasing a series of singles, including Dead Horse and You Bring the Morning, fans helped him to crowdfund his sophomore release, Poet Priest. Lauded as beautiful, brutal music by Brett McCracken, this album would define a new season in Andy's life, one where he was eventually able to step into music full-time and release his own writing with the books Poet Priest Volume 1 and Poet Priest Volume 2. The album itself was also accompanied by a release of voice demos of the entire album. In this time, Andy's authentic and curious essays on social media would also shape the way people consume music and think about faith in light of patriarchy, politics, consumerism, and grief. Appearing on John Lucas's album, The Bible Belt Sessions, in 2022, Andy's work would go on to appear on playlists curated by the Gospel Coalition, UTR Media, and The Rabbit Room, showing the far-reaching effect of his music, which had crossed multiple audiences and parts of the church. Appearing at Audio Feed Music Festival in 2023, a three-day music festival held in Urbana, Illinois over the July 4 weekend, Andy has been invited back, and this year he's a headliner and guest speaker, inviting people to find community and to share ideas and faith. Now, Audio Feed is similar to the old Cornerstone Festival, but more indie, super left of center. There's not just one genre, everything is represented here. This is the equivalent of Disneyland for hardcore music lovers and people who want to meet friends and fellow misfits. I spoke to Andy about Audio Feed, his new single Death Defying Joy, and his recent comments about Christian music. This is such a good conversation. My friends, meet Andy Squires. Andy Squires, or Henry Squires, but it's Andy today, Andy Squires. Welcome to the Between You and Me podcast.
Thank you for having me. It's just so great.
It's so good to finally connect with you. And now you've been in this industry for quite a while. You are singer, songwriter, author, poet. I'm not going to I feel like it would discredit you to say Instagram influencer. You're not an influencer, but you have really great content. I think personally, as a writer. So I would like to know, in your own words, who is Andy Squires?
Well, gosh, first and foremost, just an ordinary man, married, happily married to Amy for 30 years. We have a large family. Most of my kids are grown and on their own now, doing their own thing. So that's, yeah. But then I've given the bulk of my life to music and pursuing writing and poetry, and I've been in and out of church work as well, among my many other attempts at making a living at various jobs over my life. But I, you know, the poet priest moniker that I've used on an album and then now on my series of books, that a friend gave me that in 2015. I had been kind of struggling with feeling out of step with the church world, and then but simultaneously feeling out of step with just the world in general. And I was not able to make sense about where I belonged, if my music, I mean, I write about God a lot, so it seemed like the Christian music world was kind of the obvious thing, but it just in the way that I talked about God, or the way that I sang or composed, it just obviously wasn't fitting that general format. So, but he gave me the phrase, Andy. My friend said to me, Andy, it's not that you don't belong in either. It's that you belong in both. You're the poet priest. And that just made, it was such, you know, sometimes we need our friends to help us, articulate ourselves back to us. And so when I heard that, I was like, oh my goodness. And so maybe that's who I am. I mean, it's not all encapsulating, but it's a good starting point at least.
Yeah, I mean, it's a pretty loaded question, so that's a pretty good answer, in fairness. Yeah. Well, my next question was probably equally as loaded, honestly, and this just gives you free rein. I want to know your story. Like, okay, so you're here in this moment. You've released multiple albums, poetry since 2015. You've worked in multiple churches. You've been married for 30 years. You've got multiple kids, and you get to this point in 2024. How did Andy Squires get here, where like music is a thing that you do because you love it and you feel called to it, but as we know, it's not necessarily the easiest or even the most wealthy like idea. So how did you get to this point where you are still making music and creating art and meaningful content right now in 2024?
I'm actually only recently at it full time, in the last 2 years. It's always been a side thing for me, although I wished it had been full time a lot sooner. But it does seem to be a little bit of a God moment for me. Maybe kind of like the convergence of multiple projects, or I don't know, rivers, streams, whatever metaphor you want to pick, it's fascinating. I arrived here because, first of all, I've never given up on art. I've never given up on art making in general. So that's one of the reasons why I'm here doing this right now. Since I was maybe a teenager, I've looked for words to help me explain life. And so I wasn't always good at words, but I was always good at just doing it, even though I wasn't good at it, if that makes sense. Like, I was willing to be bad at this for a really long time. And then, you know, grew up in the church, and then in my early adulthood, kind of got the idea, oh, maybe I should be a worship songwriter. And so for a while there, I was making an attempt at writing songs that maybe a guy like Chris Tomlin would record, or, you know, somewhere in the vein of like, I never imagined myself being Chris Tomlin or doing it like the Hillsong thing, but just at least being in that publishing world, because there is a lot of income available in that world. And, you know, as a few people have figured out, you know, for better or worse at this point. But it was always like a bit of fish out of water for me, because there were so many other things that I wanted to hear within music, hear within just the conversation in general. So around 2009, I decided to make a record. Wasn't the record first. I made a decision to start writing songs that I would want to listen to, and which it's a big shift for somebody in that world. Cause I think in the Christian art world, at least the main obsession is, what are other people going to think about this? What can a congregation sing this? Will this, you know, all those kinds of things. And I just stopped caring about that. I was like, you know, I'm not being faithful to what I feel in my heart. I'm not being faithful to the words that I feel coming up in myself. And so once I started to not care about what anybody thought about my music anymore, it was incredible what happened. My songs just, they finally touched the nerve. And then the irony of it is that when I stopped caring about what my audience might think, that's when I actually gained an audience. It was really interesting. And so over the course of the last 15 years, at least, I've been working at being as faithful to the things that I want to say as possible. And whether it's in my writing or in my music. And then within the last 2 years, there's been enough of a draw or a demand on what I do that I can actually go tour, you know, full time, you know, playing my songs, reading essays from my books. I kind of do a thing where I speak, I sing, I, you know, kind of do this audience back and forth thing, because people have a lot of questions for me for some reason. So, that's how I ended up here.
I want to ask you a little bit about this idea of Christian music, if it's all right, knowing that your career, your art is so much broader than just the idea of that and even the consumerist culture with it. I wouldn't want to do a disservice to you in that. But I know that you posted recently, purely merely because people kept asking you questions, when an artist, did a great real thing about Christian music taking over culture. Whatever, for me, I'm like, you do you, great, don't know that guy. But what was fascinating to me was the feedback and the input that more established artists had on that. I wanted to hear what you guys were saying because you've written this out and been in this for a long time. You know it really well. And so I wanted to, well, you sort of semi-answered it with actually that previous question, but I wanted to ask you in terms of Christian music, and I'm talking the media of Christian music, the Nashville-based conglomerate where people make money off publishing and touring and all that sort of stuff. Do you see yourself as a part of that, a part of like that machine? Or do you see yourself as like a peripheral part of it who just happens to like nearly fall adjacent because you sing about God?
This is going to sound slightly arrogant when I say this, but I do feel a part of that thing, but I would say that I'm on the prophetic edge of it. So I would say that my role, just the fact that I exist because of the nature of what I do have a sense that I don't think people feel threatened by what I do, but I definitely feel like I'm revealing the possibility that more can be said and more can be done, artistically speaking. But in the hierarchy of values within that particular industry, I wouldn't say that art appreciation is it might not even be in the top 10 values on that hierarchy of values on that list. And I need to be careful because I don't want to come across, I don't want to say that I am the most talented and creative person because I'm not. I'm a poor musician. I'm not that good of a singer. I think my superpower is that I'm chasing down concepts. I think that there's theological and philosophical work that I do in my songwriting as well as my writing that is that's maybe missing from a lot of what's going on in Nashville. I do have a lot of friends that are in this world. So I do want to be careful because I don't want to say that all artists everywhere need to be thinking about this the way I am. But the problem is that I would say 99% of what is happening is something other than what I do. And so I do like to be bold in my proclamations. I would like to speak to the church and say, y'all, we need to do better than what we're doing right now. And money cannot be our motivator. There are other things at stake, besides people making a living. That's what happens when your theology and the culture that you live in is dominated by commerce. Then commerce becomes the main god that you're serving without you even knowing it. And the utilitarian aspect of money cannot be denied. I'm not trying to do all this so that I can live in poverty. I'm not doing my work so that I don't make a living. I'm actually doing my work so that I can make a living. But I don't wonder sometimes if we're emphasizing the money piece too much. And maybe there's a middle ground where we could begin as artists and industry people who are supporting artists that maybe we could start aiming at the beautiful rather than at the useful. I think like this utilitarianism that has found its way into the evangelical church is one of the saddest things that I've witnessed. And so, so yeah, that little back and forth, that little dust up that you mentioned that I was responding to on social media, I do occasionally get stirred up when I hear some artist who's got 2 million monthly followers on Spotify and millions of followers on Instagram using outsider language like that particular artist did, we're going to change the culture overnight because what I'm doing is so good that I'm going to show up and everybody, well, I went and listened to the artist's work. And as far as I could tell, and I know art is subjective, but as far as I could tell, it wasn't that different than what was being played on mainstream Christian radio, which is fine. But I just think it's kind of silly to make these claims like we're going to take over culture. First of all, I'm not sure that can ever happen. Secondly, I don't know if that's what we're supposed to be doing. That just sounds very hubristic to me, at least. So I do like the small path. I like the fact that I'm a niche artist.
I love that.
Like, I'm a subculture within a subculture, which is like, it's career suicide in a sense. But I am very thankful that at least in my little world, more and more people are finding out that there are ways of talking about God and at least aiming at an understanding of God that is more incarnational. Yeah. And I mean, I'm a Christian. I write songs, but I never am assuming that my song is Christian. I just happen to write about God because that's interesting to me, but I could write a song about anything and hopefully God would be incarnational in that thing. Mm-hmm. And it can exist apart from any evangelical agenda. Yeah. And be as beautiful as anything, if that makes sense.
I'd give you my dream, but I lost it down in the locust years. Still praise is the song that I'm singing, even though sorrow's my tune. Oh, my love is only a whisper now.
Hey, this is Darren with We Are Messengers. And this is the story behind my new song, God Be the Glory.
When the ground beneath my feet is shaking like a leaf, God, you're still good to me.
Scriptures remind us that God is glorified in our weakness. God is glorified in our brokenness, in our mourning, in our sorrow, and in our loss. But God is glorified because he remains present with us in those circumstances, and we get a first row seat to watch his goodness at work in our lives.
God be the glory ever and ever. God be the glory.
I love what you were saying. And part of the reason I loved it, it was honest, but also because I saw a lot of my younger self in that artist and what he was saying. We're probably the same age, honestly. But when I When I started in journalism, I was like, I'm gonna change culture for Jesus. And now, not bad, like Jesus is great. Like the prince, like the kingdom of heaven is amazing, right? That's a very bizarre statement. There's so much to that, sorry. But what I mean is that it was only once I started talking to artists and getting to know them and even living in Nashville for a while that I realized for me, only for me, but I realized how arrogant it sounded. It didn't come from an arrogant place, but it came from this concept of things need to be fixed. And it doesn't mean that things are perfect, but it was only once I started meeting people like you and having these conversations, even in the last 6 years when I've done this podcast, there's so much more nuance than I knew. It became
That's
so
right.
much more difficult to judge artists and even their music once I heard their stories and like heard the authenticity and their desires and their hopes and their brokenness. And that's for me what was so compelling about your response. One, the fact that you chose to respond. I know quite a few different artists did, but knowing there seems to be for me such wisdom in going to often to the artists who have been doing this for the long haul, because at least from what I've learned, if I, as a generalization, and I literally started my podcast with this 6 years ago, said basically, I don't like Christian music, it sucks. Look, there'll be lots of people who agree with that, but I was offending 95% of my audience and guests because they were like, I create music and I just happen to be in the Christian sphere. So for me, the humanity in the middle of it is often, at least for me, where I've experienced God. And so hearing your take on it, I go, totally understand all of that. And I don't have the answers. I'm like, I'm not here to reform a culture. I'm here to tell stories and create honest art like you. And so I love the idea of artists wherever they fit, whatever genre or sub-subculture, wherein we get to create art that sort of embodies the heart of Christ in the most authentic way possible to how he works through us. Yeah. Anyway, that was my take on that. But I just want to say thank you for your honesty. Knowing I get it. A lot of the aspect, I see a lot of myself in that entire journey. Sorry, I'm still learning, but I appreciate it.
We never stop learning, do we?
Never. Nah, never. It's always humbling. Always.
That's right.
Actually, this probably goes with my next question is actually about a recent Instagram post that you had, and you're probably thinking which one, but you actually talked about trading, or actually maybe it was the same conversation, my bad, trading influence, oh sorry, trading like your calling or your art for influence, and you equated it like with Esau and Jacob and the bowl of soup. And I want to talk to you about your crafts now, just your career. What does it look like for you every day now, especially now that you're full time? And you're making somewhat of a living off this. What does it look like to ensure that you are not trading your calling for influence?
Well, I always have to monitor myself if so writing, let's just talk about my writing for a second. If when I'm not on the road traveling, I get up in the morning, I have a cup of coffee, I go into my office and I pull up my laptop or my notebook and I begin to write. Now, writing at this point for me is very instinctual. I have instincts that guide me. There are things that interest me. There are things that I've observed, and I'm usually writing some kind of response to things that I've observed. In the course of that writing, my gut is telling me what to write. Now, if I ever stop in that moment and say, maybe I shouldn't say that way. Well, the first thing I have to ask myself is, what is it that you're preserving? Are you not wanting to say it that way because that's not the best way to say it, which is sometimes the case? Or are you not wanting to say it because you're going to hurt somebody's feelings? Now, to me, writing should never be like a constant nuclear option where you're just out here creating conflict and controversy. Like, there's plenty of people on the internet who have derived an incredible amount of a living by controversy-inducing statements. That's not what I feel called to as a writer. But I do feel called to not sterilize my language for the sake of some of my audience. Some of my audience would probably identify themselves like right in the middle of the evangelical mainstream, of which I'm a part, and happily so. I know a lot of people have kind of like scorned that phrase, but at this point, I don't feel a need to. I feel very at home in that world. I'm not happy with everything in that world, but those are the people who marked me, and therefore I'm not going to abandon ship at this point. But the calling on my life that I sense from the Spirit is to challenge the status quo within that world. And so if I feel tempted to kind of like tamp down my witness or to not say something because I know it'll make my income smaller, well, that's the point for me where I have to go to the Lord and say, listen, this might be something I just need to give up to you because I feel compelled to go ahead and say this thing that I'm going to say. And so that's where I have to, as an artist, be willing to pay the cost constantly. I said this recently, but there's an amount of suffering that is associated with our vocational callings as artists, as journalists, whatever thing that it is that you've been asked to do or called to do. It's not a gravy train of constant physical health and all the money that you could ever want. Like, it's not that. I don't know why we ever got that idea, but to me, I don't want to be at the end of my life looking back going, gosh, I should have played it safer and made music and said words that everybody everywhere loves. Like, to me, if you're not producing work that derives an immense amount of admiration and immense amount of hatred at the exact same time, you're not doing it well. Like, I think that an artist's work should create a contrast of reactions. And so I try to mitigate my need for money and renown and all of those things by kind of like constantly reminding myself that the work that I'm called to do, not everybody is called to do it, but I am. And if I am to remain faithful, then I've got to take some beatings. I can't be afraid of taking some beatings occasionally, you know?
Yes.
We're myself included, we're always trying to like keep the pain away, but sometimes that's the only path through, is to kind of like be honest with yourself and go, you know what? If you put this out, some people are really going to misunderstand you. That's been my whole career, is people misunderstanding what I do. And like your natural instinct is to like go around trying to explain yourself to people. But I think I've made peace with it. Like, just being, I'm okay with being misunderstood all of the time. I really am. And sometimes people want to fight me. Like there's occasionally somebody wants to fight me online, but I'm not a debater. I'm not good at arguing about things really. So I don't really spend my life like answering angry people online. But if somebody really is like curious and wants to know about what I think about something, I will definitely work to maybe make myself clearer in what I mean.
Conceived in anger, born into a rage, raised by wolves who fed me on the injustice of the age. My mother left me outside a stranger's door. Oh, she heard the howling wind and could not refuse it anymore. Before you, God, I am opening my heart. I know you did not expect me. I'm a thief in the night. Before you, God, I will leave the 99 to find you in the darkness. I will not.
How does your latest single, Death Defying Joy, I mean, it's a few months old now, but how does that fall into this for you? What was, like, I hate saying the heart behind it because I know that's such a generic way of asking a question, but tell me about the song.
Yeah, so I come from a Pentecostal charismatic background. I'm still in a charismatic church, and we're big on miracles. Like, we really are. Our hopes are high. But I like to call my tribe, my people, we're the people of perpetual disappointment. That's how I describe charismatic people. And the tension looks like this. We have a high view of God's work in the world, meaning he didn't stop working at the close of the canon of Scripture. We believe he continues to work today. And part of that work means seeing physical healings, prayers answered, you know, the gifts of the Spirit in operation as described by the Apostle Paul in Corinthians. And I've maybe over the past couple years, I've swung back towards the miraculous because there was a time when I couldn't deal with my disappointments anymore in those things. And so I started like tending towards like an active cessationism in my own life. But I realized I didn't like where I was going with that, where I was like putting a stop to believing in the supernatural side of the Christian faith. And I was like, okay, I can't do that. I don't like where my heart's going. So I've come back to this place where I've taken the charismatic approach of always contending or at least believing that the miraculous still happens, mm-hmm. but making at the same time, making plenty of room for the miracle, the possibility of the miracle not happening. Which I think has been the downfall of charismatic Pentecostal philosophy. We haven't made room for the miracle not happening in our worldview. And which in my view has actually led a lot of people to their deconstruction. Like that failure, that philosophical failure has led a lot of folks to like, well, it's either God does these things or he's not real, you know? And so like, to me, there's gotta be a middle ground. So Death Defying Joy was kind of like, well, it's a bit cheeky. Like there's a lot of jokes going on in that song, you know, like I compare God. So in the charismatic world, we use the phrase breakthrough all the time.
Oh, right? Yeah.
So So you're familiar. So,
oh yeah.
So, but like in that song, in the second verse, I compare God. God's a bowl in a china shop. Like, and so when I wrote that line, it's like, you're a bowl in a china shop, always breaking through. So I'm like attaching this charismatic trigger word to this image where, yeah, no, God really just does whatever he wants. And your prayers aren't really that much a part of this as you think they are, you know? And then when I get to the chorus, if you hear your name, if you hear me, how does the line go? If you hear your name in vain, it's me looking for you again. You know,
I heard that one. Yeah. Oh, yes.
Yes. Oh, yeah. So it's like, I mean, that's just such a favorite moment in Christians are like, don't take the Lord's name in vain. Well, I'm taking that and I'm reworking it. You know, that's the way we feel. We're crying out to God on a normal basis. And yet we, in some sense, what we get back is silence. So there is a vain repetition to this, isn't there? Like, so it's like I'm couching the reality of this very difficult relationship, or seemingly difficult relationship, in a joyful thing. It's like, you know, I mean, in the bridge, it gets to that place in you. How's it go? With you, with or without miracles, like that was my favorite line of that song. Like, kind of giving myself space to never stop believing, never stop expecting, but always kind of ready for all hell to break loose, you know? And like, that's the stuff that interests me. That's the stuff that I don't hear on Christian radio. So that's why I go and write that stuff.
Yeah. I mean, I've had same experience. So I appreciate that. Absolutely.
Like the wind, I don't know where you've been or where you go. You're an unpredictable cloud of crazy. Like a fire burning low, I saw you in the early glow. Like some kind of beautiful, only the blind can see. Don't change your plans on my account. I finally got you figured out. Faith is not provoked without a word of irony. If you hear your name in vain, it's me looking for you again. Crushed beneath the spirit wind from glory to glory to glory to glory. Tongues of fire on my head, all my assumptions are dead. Scandal is the daily dread, the honesty with you. Pressure of the surgeon's knife, you have always been precise. A bowl in the china shop of my life, always breaking through. Don't change your plans on my account.
I've nearly finished. I've got a few like quick popcorn questions to throw at you. But sure. Before I do that, I did want to ask you about Audio Feed, which is why we're connecting, the festival that's happening over the July 4 weekend. Can you tell me, now, have you been to Audio Feed before?
I went last year for my very first time, and it was just incredible.
Okay, so tell me about, like, being asked back your sets, what you liked about it.
Well, it was a real shock to me at first. I mean, it's such a diverse group of people. Like, I honestly couldn't believe all the different parts of the body of Christ that I saw there. And you know, it's not everybody's cup of tea. It's very on the edge. It's very there's just all kinds of artists there. There's just the fringe of the music world is there at Audio Feed. And like, it's just my, it's my cup of tea, you know? And, but it's also very community oriented. There's a very wonderful sense of belonging and community with it, you know, even within all the diversity, it's like, oh my goodness, it's such a, it feels in a sense like the kingdom of God, like, you know, I'm sorry. Ask me the question again. I lost track.
No, I was literally asking a very open-ended question, but tell me about Audio Feed and what it's like. Cause I've never been, I don't live close enough, but I know some of the people who help organize it. And when it comes to like music festivals, it doesn't seem like a Christian music festival, but it is a music festival that has lots of like faith adjacent artists, and it's not afraid to like steer into that. Which just made me really excited. I'm like, oh, I wish I lived close enough for this. But I was honestly just curious. I think a lot of our listeners, some of them like are super into like CCM, but there'll be a lot like you who are like, I'm on the fringes and not quite sure where I fit. But I think this is my scene. I think this is where I can, I'm reminded that I belong at the table of God with all these other misfits. And that's the impression I got of Audio Feed.
You bring the gladness, I'll bring the gleaming. You bring the glory, I'll bring the singing. You bring the table, I'll bring the feasting. Somewhere in the distance, I hear wedding bells ring. I'll bring my thinking. You bring the new wine, Lord, I'll bring the drinking. You bring your spirit, I'll bring my weeping.
Popcorn questions.
Okay, I think that's all my like important mandatory questions that I need to ask you. I have a few popcorn ones.
Yeah.
Some light, some heavier. We'll take it however you like. Okay. Number one, if you could go back to 2009 and Andy is just finally releasing music and people are finally like getting it and then you're like, I have an audience. What would you say to yourself knowing what you know now?
Oh my goodness. I would say that anything worth doing is worth doing slowly. There's no hurry. You can build the world that you want to see, but you don't have to do it in a week. You can take 30 or 40 or even 50 years to do it. All of this is going to be like each record, each book or essay, these are all just bricks in the wall. It's not like your record's going to change the world overnight. No, this is a slow burn. So take your time, enjoy it. Don't feel like you can work steadily and you can work diligently. I'm not trying to make a case for not working, but I'm just saying don't feel that sense that we get sometimes that you have to complete this stuff while you're young and that you have to complete this stuff in 1 year's time. This is a lifelong project. That's what I would tell myself.
I need that reminder. Thank you. Number two, what is the weirdest comment that you can publicly share that you've received on social media?
The weirdest comments. My goodness. I don't think I can't remember. I can't remember any particular comments, but I do remember a post that I posted, I think in early 2022. I posted an essay called "It's Okay If You Don't Deconstruct." And whoo, I woke up out of bed and just thought to myself, you know, it seems like everybody's deconstructing these days, which is perfectly fine. I wasn't in my essay, I wasn't even making a case against deconstructing. All I was saying was, you don't have to invent this thing just in order to keep up with everybody. It's like, you know, it's like, oh, all my friends are deconstructing. I guess I must need to as well. So anyways, but the kind of firestorm that particular essay set off. And so I guess I at some point got some ugly comments where people were no longer kind of addressing points that I was making and were just instead being just mean, which, you know, that's it's the internet. Of course this is going to happen, right? So yeah, that was probably kind of like the hairiest moment that I've had with folks online. I do get I it's it is interesting. I now get many poets reaching out to me wanting to send me their books so that I'll read their poetry books. Like people that are kind of like making a go at this, you know, who are trying to kind of like get their start. And so that's a very interesting symptom. I'm actually highly encouraged by that because it tells me that there are many people that are looking for language. Like, we need theological language to create these categories of understanding God, but systematic theology is insufficient for understanding the greatness of God. So we have to have more poetry. Like, we just do. I believe that with all my heart. So anyways, I would say that was maybe the most interesting thing that I comment that I get online a lot. Can I have your address so I can send you my book?
It's like, let me find a PO box. Sure. Yeah. Well, okay. Last question. What is the funniest moment you've ever had during a live performance?
Oh, that is so interesting. What an interesting question. Oh my gosh. Well, there's a lot of laughter in my shows. Just because I sing so many sad songs after another, I have to be really funny between my songs. Otherwise, it's just too much for people. But one of the funniest moments that I've ever actually experienced, I was doing a house show in Knoxville, Tennessee. And somebody had a Pentecostal charismatic outbreak. They were sitting in the back of my show. I'm performing. We're just having a regular old time with this. And somebody starts like having a fit in the back. And I was like, I don't know how to deal with this. I mean, everybody in the room kind of got uncomfortable. It was kind of a moment. We were like, and they ended up calming down, but they were just getting so touched by the songs. They just started like wailing and
Spirit was like,
crying out. So that was maybe the most like, well, what was that kind of moment? So, but
wow.
I'll take what comes, you know.
Okay, not sure. That's amazing. Well, I'm glad
was
that the Pentecostal charismatic upbringing in you probably, even though it takes you aback, you're probably like, well, at least I know what that is.
Yes. So that's yeah. Exciting. Yeah. If I had been a Baptist in that room, I would have been very uncomfortable.
Thank you so much for chatting with me today.
Oh, you're so welcome.
Between a rock and hard place, some of us welcome, some of us not, some of us the scapegoat, some of us the mob, all of us guilty, then all of us free, a cup of joy poured out to our great relief. So when the abyss had us tied to the rails, like a runaway train, love never fails.
You know, sometimes you have to walk a fine line when you interview people. You're like, what do I ask? How can I ask it? And if I say this, am I putting them in a really awkward position? Because, I mean, you can talk about some things in the public sphere and people don't always respond well, right? And people can take it the wrong way. One great thing about Andy Squires is that he's very thoughtful in his responses. He is so articulate, but he's not afraid to answer those questions. And there's a lot of reasons why people can and can't answer hard questions in different ways, but I really loved Andy's tenacity in sort of going shoulder to shoulder with me and talking with me about Christian music and this new era of Christian music, if that's even a thing, and TikTok and Forrest Frank and what it looks like to lose our ego and to pursue calling over fame and influence and how that's an internal battle every day. It was something that I related to, not being a music maker, but as a creative, it's something that I related to, and it's something that I'm so drawn to in music in general and in Christian music. When people are willing to open up and share these ideas and wrestle with them, and perhaps it's not always popular, but it's really raw and real. And often for me, that's where I find it, like a lot of, when I say my people, people who have gone through similar life experiences or probably have stories of pain that they've journeyed through that have brought them to a point where they love to hold space for people who are different to them. That's my favorite. I experience the church. I experience God in those moments. And that's one thing that I've really loved in the last couple of years as I've learned more about the independent Christian music. It's not really an industry. It's like a bunch of people all collaborating. But I have loved connecting and with and hearing so many of those artists because it's not about, and it's not to say this is for other people, but it's not about fame. It's not about making money. It's about making fearless, authentic art and hoping that people respond and relate to that and hoping that God provides some money along the way. And it has been so eye-opening and so humbling for me hearing that music and meeting those people. So thank you so much, Andy, for being so honest and real with me. Friends, you can get the single Death Defying Joy now on all streaming platforms. His latest album, Poet Priest, is available on all good streaming platforms. And if you would like to pick up copies of his books, Poet Priest Volume 1 or Volume 2, you can get them now on his website at andysquires.com. You can also connect with Andy directly online. He's on Instagram at Andy Squires. That's A-N-D-Y. And Squires is S-Q-U-Y-R-E-S. All those links are in the show notes. And while we're at it, if you would like to get tickets to Audio Feed for this July 4 weekend, go for it. Go see Andy live. Go see our friends and citizens live. Go visit our friends at the UTR Media event going on for Rich Mullins. There is an extraordinary lineup. So just go and check out audiofeedfestival.com and buy your tickets, or just suss out the information and plan a road trip with your friends if you don't live nearby. It should be a lot of fun, and I wish I lived closer so that I could also attend. Friends, thank you so much for tuning in for this episode. Now, a friendly reminder that you need to go and subscribe to this podcast if you haven't already done so. Please and thank you, to quote Ron Swanson. You'll find the Between You and Me podcast on all good podcast platforms, which you already know if you're listening to this. And you can also connect with us online at betweenyouandmepod.com. You'll find us on Instagram at betweenyouandmepod. And while you're on all your podcast platforms, make sure you give us a star rating and check out our website for merch and other fun stuff and 6 years worth of episodes and interviews just like this one. Friends, that's all I have for this episode, but in 2 weeks, we will be hearing from a wonderful independent writer called Matt Wheeler. Matt is adjacent to the UTR Media Group, who I work with as a freelancer, and he's a folk singer-songwriter heavily influenced by literature. His latest album was literally influenced and is about Wendell Berry's work. So we have a wonderful, fun conversation for all you like literature lovers out there and people who love Tolkien and C.S. Lewis. This is your jam. Make sure that you stay tuned for that in 2 weeks. Friends, thank you so much. I will see you then. Here's to hope.
Oh, another great episode of the Between You and Me podcast. Hi, my name is Aiden, and each week on Songs That Change You, I'm joined by a guest to discuss a song that has had a real impact on their walk with God.
Portions of the day's programming are reproduced by means of electrical transcriptions or tape recording.
And you might think, eh, it's just a song, but songs can be powerful.
There was no hope, and but there God was running, chasing after me, you know, that I was able to know him as a father, but also a friend. That's why this song means so much to me.
There's a line in the song, "Walk me down the aisle, Daddy." And I honestly went through this process of not being sure if I'd actually be able to walk my daughter down the aisle.
Songs That Changed You. Check it out wherever you listen to podcasts.
When the ground beneath my feet is shaking like a leaf, God, you're still good to me. When my hope is all but gone and I'm barely hanging on, God, you're still good to me. When my heart can't find the beat, when it's dark and I can't see, I will put my hope in you. Ashes for beauty, joy for my morning. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Strength for my weakness, pain for my healing. Let this be my story. To God be the glory. Oh, oh, oh. You love me at my best. Love me in my mess, God, you're so good to me. There's one thing I am sure, your promises endure. You make a way for me. When my heart can't find a beat, when it's dark and I can't see, I will put my hope. I will fall.